Venerable Vimalanyani, Bhikkhuni, it was such a joy and a privilege really for me to get your letter, and I was overjoyed really because Therigatha is something very special, very close to my heart. Over 30 years ago when I was a layperson and I was working at the university in Sri Lanka, I read the Therigatha in translation by Mrs. Reese Davis, and I was really crying with tears. Where are these bhikkhunis? Where are these theories? And then I was wondering, my goodness, and reading the Therigatha, that changed my whole life. Because I was a science person, I've been in US and studying science, master's in molecular biology, but I thought, they don't give me the answer that I want. I was asking them, the professors, why are we born? Why are we suffering? Why are we dying? So, but they said, no, science has not discovered anything about why we are born. So then I was so frustrated about following the science career. Then I came back home to my family and then entered the Sri Lankan University where they teach, where I did my postgraduate in Pali and Buddhist philosophy. And then I was going to the Tripitaka, and then accidentally I came across the Therigatha. And having read it, I thought, my God, what scientific knowledge is this compared to the science they are talking about? And then I saw their supernormal qualities and their ability to recall previous lives and their ability to become arahants. So, and how the Buddha rescued the Bhikkhuni order and made them equal to the Bhikkhu order. Because when the Buddha was preaching, on the left side were seated in the front row the monks, and behind them the layman. And on the left side in the front row were the bhikkhunis seated, and behind them the lay women, the fourfold society. And then these are the people who became arahants and started remembering their previous lives and remembered their present lives and made these gatha, these stanzas. It was so revealing, unbelievable, how they suffered due to their previous karma. So it talks about karma and rebirth. It talks about supernormal powers. It talks about their previous lives and the cause for their suffering. And then, I mean, the most important aspects, the causes and conditions, how they follow you life after life. Not necessarily done in this life, but previous life karma can come upon you as vipaka. So we learn so much that what we are paying up is not for what we have done in this life, but it could be previous lives in samsara. So it tells us the fearful nature of samsara. And it tells us how the Buddha said, even for the snap of a finger, I wouldn't recommend samsara, and said the best thing you can do is get out of it as fast as you can. And then I was amazed. These people, some of them so downtrodden, because that was the time when the Buddha came into this world, the women were considered the worst caste, because there was the Kama Sukalikanu Yoga, and the man was the one who studied Veda, and he was quite mature and maybe 30 years or more, and the women were not allowed to study the Vedas, and they were ignorant females, and so many of them are child brides. So I was so amazed, the condition of women. Sometimes the parents arranged the marriage, and the little girl grew up in the husband's house. To that extent, they were children themselves, and they bore children, and then they were treated like worse than servants because they were uneducated, and they were called Dwangula Panya. It means a two-finger consciousness. They have no brains. The daily they cook the rice, but they have to see whether it is boiled by pressing it with the two fingers. So, and they were always fighting. They were fighting for toys, their children and their children themselves, with babies, and all living together in the same house. So such downtrodden women came up as our house, and they are speaking the paeans of joy that they now enjoy as arahants, and their suffering in this life and their previous karma done, for which they are paying up their, they were paying up their sins. So it was very revealing, the Buddha word, and then always they spoke up and said that Buddha was the one savior who gave them all this advantage, and they resurrected themselves from the depths of this despair to the highest limit of becoming bhikkhunis and then equal to men. And the Buddha considered them in the equal to men in the sense, in the Ratana Sutra, you say, Ye Puggala Atta Satam Pasatta, the great men, Chattari Etani Yugani Hotu. Chattari means four. Yugani means two. The four into two is the eight. They are Dakkhinaya Sugatasa Savaka. He calls them, they are the real disciples, these eight men, the four Sotapatti, Magga, and Pala. And then the Buddha says, the Dakkhinaya, one who gives them gifts, get great merit in return, and it's a field of merit that you sow in a very fertile soil, and then you get great returns. So the women and men, even the women, lay women, if they have got stages of sainthood, Then also they become one of the eight men. So they have given up their sexuality of being considered women. The Buddha called them Atta Purisa. Purisa Puggala. Purisa means male. Puggala, they are males. So they are born female. The Buddha considered them even lay people. So they are the real disciples of the Buddha. Not the ones that appear to be in robes. They are only the Sammuti or the conventional Sangha. But these eight men, they are the real disciples, the Paramattha Sangha, in the highest sense of being the Buddha's disciples. So the women became equal in every respect. And when I read these stories of some of those theories, I was crying. Then I thought, well, this Bhikkhuni order must come. That's the time I gave up my science career and started thinking of the Bhikkhuni order. So it changed my life. And today I have this great privilege of speaking a few words, though I am 92 years and I can hardly speak, and my eyesight is bad, my hearing is bad. Even then, my friend Sohani is such a wonderful girl. She brought all these things and said, you must participate in the Therigatha Festival. Unfortunately, in May, I'm not here in Colombo, so I'll be away, very far away from Colombo. I cannot do it, so I thought I will record it. And Sohani brought all the equipment, and she's by me and monitoring me and supporting me, she and her husband Dilshan. What wonderful people, if not for which I'm unable to even speak one word. So my heartfelt thanks to you for having this festival and sponsoring and making it a worldwide truth and fact that we cannot contest. They cannot be contested. They are not ambiguous. They are not contradictory. They all speak the same thing. And again, they speak about the Buddha, how the Buddha rescued them. And all of them in one voice say more or less the same thing. So these Therigathas talk about karma and vipaka. They talk about their previous lives and their wisdom and their divine eye and their having trividya. All the time they talk about trividya. That is Pubbe Nivasa, Dibba Chakku, and Asavakkaya. So all of them were blessed with a highly, what can I say? They conquered Mara and they possessed the highest wisdom. And they saw the utter futility of worldly living and achieved the highest discipline. And they were now enjoying the cool comfort of Nibbana. So I am able to, I think I don't have to say much because it is such common knowledge for you. Maybe I will send you an email of a free translation I did from the Pali to English of the Therigatha. You may take extracts or do whatever you like. And I hope I have said enough. Of course, there's so much what I have. Because of my age and disability, I can't do much. But I thank you most sincerely for remembering me. And it was such a joy for me, the Therigatha. Therigatha is so close to my heart. Thank you, dear Arya Venerable Arya Jnani. You are doing a great... Vimalanyani, na? I'm sorry. Thank you, Ayya Vimalanyani. And all the guests in finding sanctuary, the series of conversations as they journey through these beautiful, inspiring verses. Thank you.